Thank you. It's amusing, very, very sacred to the covenant of Neville and Yvonne, as it is words from their sessional song. And for those who are not familiar to Salvation Army ways, when people train to be Salvation Army officers, they become part of a session. Each session is given a name. And something of that name kind of celebrates the calling that God's people receive into officership. And it forms and shapes something of the ministry that officers then do in the name of Jesus. And Neville and Yvonne were messengers of peace. And here we are today, in this place, in the presence of Him who is the Prince of Peace, Jesus. And He said these words on one occasion, "Peace is what I leave with you. It is my own peace that I give you. I do not give it as the world does. Do not be worried or upset." In this service of thanksgiving and celebration of Neville's life, Yvonne, Claire, Kirsty, Rebecca, Peter, and the family, want us all amidst the pain, the loss, the hurt of losing Neville, they want us each to experience that peace that Jesus gives. A peace that is permanent. Jesus said, "I leave it with you." A peace that is personal. "It is my own peace that I give you." A peace that is preeminent to all other peace. "I give you a peace that the world cannot offer you." And so we come today to celebrate the life of a messenger of peace who lived and loved to serve God and serve Jesus, the Prince of Peace. And so on behalf of Yvonne and the family, I say thank you for being here today as part of this celebration. It's lovely to see people from the wider family here, people from some of Neville Yvonne's previous appointments, fellow officers from within the division and out of the division, colleague officers from other DHQs and THQ here today. Also great to see fellow Salvations, of course, here from Morriston and far and wide, who are here to celebrate Neville's life. And also to have other people who have shared in life with him. We have a representative from the fire service to represent Neville's commitment to emergency service response, and other colleagues who also worked with him in that ministry. We also have a fellow church minister who is here sharing. We are all here to celebrate the life of a husband, a dad, a granddad, a brother, a family member. The life of a Salvation Army officer, Major Neville, who loved the Lord, that called him and served him. And he served. And he was faithful and fruitful in that service. And so as we celebrate his life today, because the family want this to be a celebration of his life, we stand together and we sing the song, "What a Faithful God Have I." The band will give us an introduction, then we'll sing the song. Let's rise to sing.
Thank you.
wisely. You, Yvonne, and the children and the grandchildren, God is faithful. And he will meet you at your point of view. Right now, I'm going to invite to come to lead us in prayer, Reverend Canon, Hugh, Lervy, who's a fellow minister of the gospel here in Morriston, in this community. Hugh, along with Neville and Yvonne, his church and this school, have made this dance together as a witness to the mission and purpose of Jesus Christ in this community. It's lovely that Hugh is with us and will lead us in prayer.
Just a couple of words before I share prayer with you today. And, firstly, thank you for allowing me to be part of this service. I know it is unusual to have other traditions involved in service, but it is a privilege for me to be here today to share prayer with you. Just to go back, I've been vicar for local church, for those who are from away, the last 22 years and seen a number of officers come and go through that time, and each and every one of the officers that come, the relationship between us as churches and as Christians has grown and developed. Neville and Yvonne took that to a completely different level, because immediately as they came to Morriston, we felt a bond and a connection, and we have worked at all sorts of projects together. It's been a privilege to support the food bank that runs here, and I'm sure we'll hear more about it, of course, Neville's work during the tributes. One thing I will not forget about him, as I'm sure others will, is his sense of humour. I would come in, particularly through the challenges of this pandemic the last 2 years, I would come in with donations and food for the food bank. And invariably it would be Neville meeting at the door with John and Carol, and here Neville would say something like, "Here he comes from the dark side," and we would tease each other there and say, "Welcome to become an Anglican," and he said, "Well, come and become a Salvationist," but we had a bond, and I said, "I will hold on precious memories, I'm sure we all know of Neville's life, but I just want to say to the family, you are in my thoughts, prayers, you all are as a core, but to Neville, thank you." Let us pray. Be still and know that I am God. Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Jesus said, "Today, you will be with me in paradise." Heavenly Father, we are blessed to know that your Son Jesus Christ is with us at every moment of our lives, and that he is with us today as brother, saviour, friend. As we gather today to mourn our beloved Neville, we also come to celebrate his life and his ministry. Bring healing, Lord, into our hearts today. Be our Alpha and Omega, our beginning and our end. May this service today reflect the glory of your name and the faith that guided Neville throughout his life. There is so much today we could share about Neville, but a man, firstly, of faith, a family man, a man who was there for others, nothing too much trouble. Neville could offer love, show support. There he would be graciously, humbly serving him in whose name he was called. So we pray for you as a family today. May you feel Jesus' hand gently on your shoulder, saying, "I will never leave you or forsake you," that he stands with you today. We pray for you as a church family gathered here today. The gospel too is raw, but Jesus again is with you and he will lead you forward. To the days, the weeks, the months, the years that are ahead, Heavenly Father, fill our lives with memories of Neville. Thank you for his ministry. Thank you for his love. Thank you for his friendship and for the ultimate difference that knowing him has made in our lives. Bless those who are sharing our service today in music, word and tribute. God give you strength as you stand here today to share your thoughts. Jesus said, I am the resurrection, I am the life. Those who live and believe in me will never die. That is the faith today. Neville, take your rest in God's eternal kingdom. Well done, good, my faithful servant. Amen.
Today, our words of prayer and blessing over us, over you as a family, over Neville. We'll have words of tribute where we enjoy, save the memory of who Neville will always be for all of us in very different ways. We're very pleased that today, Commissioner Jill Cotterill and Trump from London to be with us to support us. Jill is going to read the tribute that a territorial commander. Has really got Neville, and we'll find out something about Neville's life. Not everything, but his army life, and we'll hear others as we go through. Thanks, Jill.
In God, we love you so much here today. Well, we're lucky having to read this, but it's a privilege to read this to faithful Salvation Army officer. And he sends his love to you today and to the wider family, the Morriston of course, and the wider family that you have that brought with you today, whatever holding you. So here we have a tribute to Major Neville Payne, promoted to glory on the 17th of April, 2020. On the occasion of the funeral of Major Neville Payne, I respectfully salute his record of officer service in the Salvation Army. And join with Salvationists in thanking God for his leadership and his ministry. We rejoice that Neville has been accorded the highest of awards, promoted to glory. And at the same time, I feel sincere sympathy to Neville's wife, Major Lloyd-Jones, his children, and all members of the family, praying that God's peace may be theirs in every week. I would want to recognise the service given in appointments throughout these past 34 years. Neville entered the Salvation Army International Training College from Bayern, Switzerland in August 1985 as a member of the Messengers of Peace Session of Cadets. It was commissioned in May 1987. Upon commissioning, Neville was appointed to Ennis Gillian Corps, followed by Lincoln Corps and Older Citadel. In 1995, there was a transfer to the Southern African Territory, firstly to Peter's Knightsburg, followed by Morriston. On return to the United Kingdom in 2001, Neville was appointed to North Walsham Corps, followed by Sudbury Corps, Hadley, Sudbury Corps, Hadley Training Centre at Chatham, Shrewsbury Ness Corps, Abergavenny Corps, and Morriston Corps, with the additional appointment of Divisional Emergency Services Coordinator. It was from Morriston that Neville was called home. Doubtless there are comrades who will possess cherished memories of the blessings received and the interest shown to them from Neville, both through his public and personal ministry. Some will be able to be present today, and their very attendance at funeral service will be their own silent prayer, while others who cannot be present will be thinking of those who gather, remembering them in prayer, and thanking memories of Neville. It is most satisfying to approach the end of one's earthly life, however short that it may be, and to be able to reflect knowing that it has been dedicated to the achievement of God's will. Salvation Army officers are, in this regard, among the most blessed of people, in that they can know the fulfilment of a life lived in obedience to God's call, and can look back and trace the hand of God in their appointments. As they have progressively said yes to the Master and moved forward in faith. Today we record our glory that one of the number has concluded his earthly chapter of service and has entered into his reward. Salvationist faith says that death is not the end. The very resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ proclaims life beyond the grave, eternal life. And today, our understandable sadness, because of human separation, is more than compensated for by our hope of everlasting life. Consequently, the occasion is not one for more recollection, but of earnest, joyful expectation. May it be a celebration of triumphant living. On behalf of Territorial leaders from days past, and our colleagues at Territorial headquarters, I send affectionate greetings and add my sincere appreciation for all that has been achieved in the earthly life of Major Neville Andrews. Servant of God, well done. Anthony Cotterill, Commissioner, Territorial Commander. God bless you. Thank you so much, Phil. Thank you for that message. I know that message comes to you from right from the beginning of this past. And as we reflect back on all the different appointments, the different places, that Neville lived and served with God. That doesn't give the whole measure of who he is. Life was about his family and about his interests. I love the fact we've got the train there as a mark of the fact that he had so many interests and passions in life. And as the songsters sing, we've got one life to live. We've got one life to live. Lord, let me live for thee. Whatever we're doing, God, whatever we're doing, let me live, Lord, for thee. So well, let the songsters bless us with their music. And then Claire is going to come and bring a family tribute after the horses.
Thank you. people knew Dad as a very knowledgeable man, who would often be described as a Noreen encyclopedia. For our family, that often meant that a walk around the museum or anywhere with information boards would take much longer than planned. A memory Rebecca has is of a walk around Cheddar Gorge with Mum, Dad and Peter, and turning around to realise that Dad was no longer with them. He had stopped to read every sign and was nowhere in sight. All of us remember that you could never ask Dad a simple question and expect a simple answer. Dad would always make sure that you knew everything about what you had just asked. Rebecca also remembers asking Dad how to turn the printer on. Dad liked his gadgets, so it wasn't a simple printer. And Dad instead gave her the full instructions of what it does. And she was still left wondering how to turn the truck on. Dad was meticulous about the details. And we all remember how much time he would spend examining each new fleet car to make sure he knew exactly what every single button did. And woe betide us if we asked him about any of it on the school run, or, as we were just sharing in the car on the way here, if his hand hovered above the sports button on the automatic car. He would go around the long way just to show us what it did. All of us, including the grandchildren, have fond memories of steam train rides with Dad. Peter particularly remembers Dad taking the time to explain how the signal box works and details about the engine. This thirst for knowledge has been inherited by granddaughter Ali, who also loves the details. And her favourite thing about Brenda was that he always took the time to explain things for them. Her favourite time being when he took her to see a bridge in Swansea designed by Brunel, and she was learning about Brunel at school. But Dad just wouldn't read all this information. He always liked things to be right. And I will always remember the look of excitement and triumph in his eyes when he found a sign at a museum about women creatures had been corrected, following his email to them after his last visit to give them the correct information. If anything wasn't right or didn't go to plan, Dad would not be happy at all. Both Peter and Rebecca remember a time when they took Lily, the family dog, out for a walk whilst on holiday, and Lily wandered off into a field. Lily crossed what looked like a crusty patch of mud with ease, and Dad went to follow her to fetch her back, walking over the same patch, to find his leg had disappeared up to the knee in a deep cow hat. Whilst everyone else was laughing at him, Dad was walking off with a huff, saying, "It's not funny. It's not funny." Another time where we were laughing at him rather than him sharing the joke was, well, Mum remembers when he volunteered to be Santa at South End Citadel. And he did not expect that this would involve him being stood in his underpants being dressed by two of the poor folk in what, well, he zipped up into what appeared to be a Mrs. Doubtfire type bodysuit Santa outfit. He was not happy about that one either. But Dad was always in his element, in his shed, with his tools, and using all his information that he gleaned from various places to create different things. Kirsty remembers all the times when she would chat to Dad, and between them, they would come up with loads of projects that they could make. For Kirsty, being able to ring Dad up and chat to him about anything and everything, even at a silly hour of the night, is a very special memory. Rebecca also remembers early mornings in South dad, in the peace and quiet, listening to the hardy-dar birds and watching the sunrise. I remember spending hours traipsing around scrapyards with dad, looking for parts for my first car, and dad showing me how to do an oil change, and change spark plugs in my car. Dad even read most of the Haynes car manual so that we could change a broken thermostat on my car together. And it was just so much fun talking and spending that time together whilst we worked. And Dad's joy in practical projects was always infectious. Peter has lots of memories of helping Dad with his model railway, as does Kirsty. He remembers Dad getting her to clean the train tracks for him whilst they chatted away. Rebecca remembers helping Dad to build Peter's first model railway around Peter's toy farm, and then spending ages, sorry Peter, putting the toy animals in the trucks and getting Dad to send them around the track. Paul remembers James, grandson, sharing some special times with Grandad and his trains too, trying to help Grandad to make them go, but possibly hindering more than helping. Ali and Charlotte remember Grandad coming to build their playhouse. And Ali remembers when Grandad made her a market school, which she named Sainsbury's. Grandad's doll's house, they spent years, I think about 7 years in total, over getting the details just right, is well loved by the grandchildren, and is a testament to his patience and desire for getting everything perfect. Ali and Charlotte also remember Grandad's bedtime godly play stories, where they could go and pick a box containing godly play equipment that he had made, and Grandad would tell them that story. However, some of Dad's projects weren't so lasting, but no less impressive. All of us kids have memories of Dad building giant sandcastles for us on the beach, and his attention to detail was always just as amazing. Shells creating our names, little flags for the shop, moats in just the right place to catch the waves, or even a steering wheel made from driftwood or seaweed when we demanded that it was not a sandcastle, it was a car. Dad was always particular about how things should be, even down to the car boot when we went away. So much so that we would always leave much, much later than planned, because it had to be just so. He would complain we were late because we didn't help him, but would complain when we did because something wasn't in the right place. So we soon learned to lean into it. He also loved the idea of a barbecue, and again, it had to be done to what he saw as precision, which we all knew as burnt. Worse still, we'd be left to clean the barbecue afterwards. Something else, we all remember how, no matter what, Dad would be there for us and did everything he could to make sure we were all safe. Rebecca remembers how she was too scared to go down the water slide at the swimming pool because of the deep pool at the bottom. And even though he absolutely hated swimming, Dad offered to take her down and lift her up at the bottom. The plan didn't quite work because he ended up landing on top of her. But it is a special memory for Rebecca that Dad did something he didn't like, yet tried his best so that she felt safe. Kirsty and Paul remember how Dad followed them in the car, going well out of his way, all the way to the door of the hospital when Kirsty was a neighbour with James, to make sure that they got there safely. And Matt and I remember when our plane back from honeymoon was diverted from Gatwick to Stansted due to snow, and Dad drove through the snow to come and rescue us, even arriving with a pair of my mum's boots because I was still in the snow with my flip-flops. In fact, rescue missions from Dad became a running theme with Matt and I, as Cardiff. And Dad somehow managed to track me on every single traffic camera to make sure I got there in it. Rebecca remembers Dad's need to keep us safe, sometimes in comical moments too, as he wouldn't be satisfied with us wearing a helmet when riding our bikes on the road. We had the helmet, little reflective flags on the back warning cars to keep their distance and pass safely, high-vis jackets, every light and reflector possible, and reflective flips on our trousers so our trousers didn't get caught. But even in moments when Dad couldn't do anything else physically to keep us safe, we remember his faith in God. Mum remembers when we were camping in South Africa, a huge storm hit quite suddenly. Mum was stuck in the toilet block, so Dad was left with us kids in the tent with water rising and the storm raging all around us. Mum came back once the storm had passed to Dad singing army choruses with us in the tent. And although the campsites around us are flooded and tents are washed away, our tent stood and the water had parted around us. We were safe. And that need to keep people safe didn't just stop with family. Mum also recalls how Dad built quarters fence during lockdown, making sure both sides of the fence were just as it should be, so neighbours did not have to worry. And as I got older, Dad would drag me out of bed to help him fill the emergency canteen unit with blankets and flasks of hot water after storms to help people in cut-off villages. In his need to help keep everyone safe and share his faith and the love of God with them in a very practical way. Something I know he has also, in more recent years, brought Peter and Harriet into and shared those special moments of practical faith with them too. As Peter said on a gift he gave to Dad, so much of who he is, he learned from Dad, including Dad's steadfast love for Jesus. Dad always found ways to share his faith with others. He loved his Christmas lights and would always go to town decorating the house. And he even went as far as creating this finished scene, complete, of course, with the Salvation Army band and the family dog, Lily the Dalmatian. Yet he would always stress the real meaning of Christmas by making sure that his major scene took centre stage, albeit complete with singing Hark the Herald Angels Sing and reading scripture. In going through some of Dad's things, Mum came across a poem that Dad kept safe. We didn't know about it, but it obviously meant something to him. As a family, I could share so many more memories. We have got time. So instead, I'm going to finish with the last few words of that poem, as it just sums up who Dad is, who Dad was, and the example he showed us all. Because you heard whenever someone called for help and lent a hand, so they were fit once more upon their own account to stand. Then told them that they owed you naught but helping them along. 'Twas help someone had given you and sent to pass it on. Because you heard whenever God called and strove his will to do, and counted it an honour that the one called was you. When you return to spirit, God will greet you with the words, I know you, faithful spirit. You're the one who always lived.
completed by the man who is called the guardian of my soul. He is your dad, Bridget, your guardian, he was your guardian. And that's because of who God was to him. And you'll hear the music through the marriage. Oh Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. You now forever kneeling, my master and my friend. And that's what Neville did. He served God to the end. And also, perhaps the words that aren't so familiar, but from the original that he started with my soul. The last verse says to God, you know my name. And where I'm going, God.
Thank you.
grounds for playing that beautiful piece of music. And I'm reminded of the words, "Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend." Can we read scripture now that proves that's who Jesus is? And that's what Jesus does. And I'm reading from John's Gospel, chapter 20, and verses 19 to 22. This is what we now know as Easter Day. And we read from verse 19. It was late that Sunday evening, and the disciples were gathered together behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Then Jesus came and stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. After saying this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy at seeing the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I send you." Then he breathed and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Amen. In a few moments' time, we'll just reflect on those words together. But before that, I'm going to ask the Coast Guard Major, David Lloyd-Jones, from Morriston, comes and shares a core tribute to the life and ministry of Major Neville Adams. And then, following on from David, we can listen to the songs to sing again. The beautiful song, "I Have Seen the Lord."
Good afternoon. It's often a duty I have at farewell meetings. Today it's a privilege to be here. There's no duty about it today. It's a privilege to be able to speak. I've often got a lot to say, they say in Morriston, but today they've chosen me to say a few words. A song that's been going through my mind since Neville passed away is a secular song by a band that had to work out called Yellow Taxi. Anybody that's from the 70s, for my time, will know there's a line in the song that says, "You don't know what you've got till it's gone." Now, THQ staff, we often wonder when you're sending us an officer, what we're going to have. And we just never know. And in farewell meetings, there's often a lot I can say about what the officers have brought to the Corps. There's often a lot I'd like to say, what I'd like to take with them when they leave the Corps. When I spoke the other Sunday, I wanted to find a container about how I could speak about Neville. And I used the whole idea of who would have thought. And we set that in a number of contexts. I'm trying to think about how can I find a different container today to talk about Neville. And it occurred to me when I was thinking about lots of things about Neville that he was a man of many skills, as Claire's alluded to, and a huge number of interests. He knew lots about lots of things. But he found something that was able to encapsulate all of those abilities. Neville was very good at craft, he had a real attention to detail, and he was incredibly creative. And Neville discovered godly play. Now, some of us will know what godly play is. Some of us remember on one of the first Sundays Neville and Mom were here, Neville said, "I'm going to do in the afternoon something to do godly play." I didn't know what it was. I walked into the hall and I thought there was a sale at work on. There was so much stuff at the front of the hall. All of Neville's godly play, I'm going to say tools, because they're tools to tell scripture stories. And he could use his craft, he could use his skills. And some of us will remember on a couple of occasions, Neville sitting on cushions with the children and telling some of these godly play stories. He was incredibly skilled at it. And I recently, just before COVID, been on a godly play training weekend. But something I learned was at the end of the godly play sessions, the storyteller will always say, "I wonder." They'll ask wondering questions. And so today I've thought it's more than appropriate to ask some wondering questions this morning. And here's the first one. And this is a question for us all. I wonder if you can recall when was in Milano's in Woodfield Street, and we had lunch with the previous officers and the Andrews. Oh, I always call the Andersons for some reason. And when they went back to Abergavenny, back to their floor, ready to pack to come to Morriston, the fool said, "That's very timely. He tells jokes all the time." And the most amazing thing about Neville's jokes was that Yvonne had heard them all before. Some of us had struggled to laugh because we didn't get them. Yvonne didn't laugh because she'd heard them before. But Yvonne, in this envelope, I found one I don't think you've heard. When I was tidying up the notice board yesterday, I found one of his jokes. If you've heard it, pretend you haven't. And it says this: the officer began his Sunday morning sermon, "My subject this morning is the milk of human kindness." The psalmist leader said, "Oh, it's condensed." I think that's a Neville sort of joke, and he would have liked to share that today. But part of the whole joke telling wasn't just to have a laugh, it actually reflected the joy in his life, the joy in his family. He was always talking about you, our adventure, our ghost, you know. Always talking about the girls, sometimes the boy. There was a joy in his service. He loved his work. And there was a joy in his work and his walk with God. Now, I don't like repeating stories, but I'm going to repeat one of them. But for some of you from other corps that have now ministered to you as your officer, people may be listening, I wonder if there's a song that you could recall that sums up Neville. Now, somebody chose the version this morning. Morriston will never forget Neville whenever we use this song, Songs of Leader. I don't care if you are fat or if you're thin. That was a few weeks ago. Neville appeared with his guitar. Chris did stand up and say, "I'm off to the Anglicans." Well, he actually said that morning. Well, we have kept him. We didn't mind. But today, Noreen alluded to it, the song played it. The song I will forever remember Neville with is the words that are in that song, "Jesus, I promise to serve you to the end." I was here with him on Wednesday as he served joyfully. Sat at the desk, doing an alternate seat. Neville should have had not the order of the founder, the order of the laminator. Because on the back of the seat, the laminator, "Do not move the seat," or "Do not adjust the seat." We won't. But, oh Jesus, I promise, he was an officer that was active, literally, to the very end. And we've got sermons over the years you can remember. Some of you might think of particular times, moments when he was preaching. I watched only this morning, Connor Cross Sunday from here. And then I remembered Hilda. And Hilda will always remember one of Neville's sermons. He was speaking about "Thou shalt not steal," or words to that effect. And saying, we've all done little things, and picked a pen up and put it in our bag. And we all listen very well. Well, that is true, we should set an example. The following Sunday, having had harvest not so long previously, Hilda went into her handbag and found one of the shakers that we used in Green Worship. So she very guiltily gave it back to them, so it really wasn't seen there. But we remember some of the more recent sermons. And I did speak of these the other Sunday, and I think we need to be reminded of them. Neville spoke about being right with each other in the fellowship. He was convinced of that. The fellowship can only flourish when we're right with each other. He spoke also about being careful with your words, and about how we should build people up. In recent weeks, he also spoke about being right with God. And very poignantly, on his final Sunday here, when he was on the eve of Valentine's Day, he spoke very honestly about things in his life he hasn't got right. "I may not have been the best husband. I may not have been the best floor officer. I may not have been the best person in food bank when people came in and chatted to me. But but I've done my best. And that's what we're asked to do, to offer our best being acceptable to God. And one that Hugh reminded me of the other Tuesday, Hugh had listened in to one of our meetings, and Neville spoke about making your mark and leaving your mark. Well, Neville has definitely left a mark on our lives. His best man had been here today. Memories of youth, people from the training college, memories of college, people from our community, people in tears here on Wednesday, people who are poor, will have been left with a mark of Neville Andrews. We can each probably come up with personal stories about his kindness. And kindnesses were shown through the community services. He loved that work. It was a perfect appointment for him. The love of those people he met at the community. Some of us in the Corps, because we've had 2 years of having such a difficult time, haven't seen some of what Neville's done, and some of us have been privileged to see it. Some of those people were in floods of tears and telling us stories this week. On the day my mother died, on judgment said, Neville heard, I'd come down for my food, he took me home and asked if I could, if he was willing for me to pray with him. We would never have known that unless that judgment said. Yvonne shared something with us on Wednesday, and she found a note from somebody who said, if it wasn't for the major, I wouldn't be here because I would have taken my life. The influence of Major Noreen was remarkable. On a personal level, many of you know I live on my own, and through lockdown, it was a very difficult period. I couldn't see anybody. I don't really have many relatives. And I was stuck in the flat for weeks, didn't really talk to people. Neville cycled 7.5 miles to see me. Christmas just gone, I spent Christmas Day, and my work took me away this year for the first time ever, and I was staying at a hotel. 5 to 1 on Christmas Day, Neville sent a message, are you okay? What's the hotel like? When he could have been enjoying his lunch, he thought about other people. But today, I wonder what reassurance Neville would want to offer us as a messenger of peace. Well, here's some verses that I found this morning. I didn't know how to finish this tribute, so I had to turn to verses of scripture. And one verse that stood out to me this morning was, O man greatly loved, fear not. Peace be with you, be strong, and of good courage. And in a world that's warring at the moment, we're horrified by what we see. Another verse of scripture that says, those who plan peace have joy. Neville would want us to be peace planners, peace makers. But I wonder whether this particular verse sums up Neville's ministry here in Morriston, his final appointment in recent times. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Amen.
8 months since we arrived in the division. It may seem like 8 years sometimes.
we have, and as long as Neville and Yvonne have been, and we've not got to know each other over the years, but we've got to know over the last 8 months. And I've met the man who is meticulous to detail. For a divisional leader, he's a joy when it comes to safeguards. He's a joy when it comes to health and safety, because I know everything was in detail. If you're coming here a couple of weeks ago, you would have seen the detail of this building, you know, corridor and people to walk in the right ways, to sit in the right places, to be safe, and to guard themselves and protect others. He was meticulous in his detail. As we have heard today, I just got glimpsed in the garage one day. We went to visit Yvonne, and I saw the garage doors open, and I could see something of the train set. Wow, the attention to detail, remarkable. Noreen asked him, because Noreen's a godly player, to come to DHQ and bring some of his godly player. Some of it, he brought it all. It took him ages, or then ages, to set it up. And he talked through everything. And the detail in his craftsmanship was superb. And I've heard about the doll's hands, we've heard about the swan. He was meticulous. Met is a word that talks about change, about making change. And not only was he a meticulous man, he was also a man of the metanoia, the Greek for transformation. As he loved to craft certain things with all his skills, he also wanted to craft the transformation of men and women and boys and girls' lives. Because he wanted them to know Jesus. And the reading we read from John's Gospel is a picture of the Jesus that he loved, that he served. And we see how Jesus could be meticulous as he lived out the metanoia. How he was meticulous to detail. We read that the disciples were gathered behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Jesus came and stood among them. He came to them where they were, and as they were, he stood among them because the detail of what they're feeling mattered to him. And no locked doors could keep him out. Well, the last few weeks, almost as if it was meant to be, on two Monday mornings, Neville sent emails to us as a DHQ team to tell us good news stories about lives being changed and transformed. People from the community coming to worship and lives being changed. People getting suits because they wanted to go for an interview for a job. You know, officers in this room today, hear that. We'd love to hear good news stories on a Monday morning and a Friday afternoon. Because maybe everything happens in between the electoral. It was as if it was meant to be. He wanted us to hear that nothing contains or locks out the work of Jesus when it's manifested in the glory of God. In service today, maybe there are people in this room today who need to hear that Jesus comes and stands among us. He stands with us where we are in life and how we are feeling, and nothing can lock him out of that. Not our fears, not our past mistakes, not our regrets. There is nothing that can stop Jesus from wanting to stand with us. And not only does he come and meet with us and stand with us, but knowing how his disciples felt, knowing what they experienced within their own souls in that moment, knowing what they were going through, his meticulous character was to say to them, hear these words, peace be with you. Those disciples needed to hear peace. Firstly, to deal with the emotional state of their lives. They were in fear. They were locked behind closed doors because they were afraid that Jesus didn't come and do anything else but stand with them and say, peace be with you. I have heard, and Noreen and I gained the evening of Neville's promotion to glory we shared with Yvonne in the house, and then the court called a prayer meeting that evening, and we came down at the end of the prayer meeting and sensed something of the numbness and something of the shock and something of the almost disbelief, but also something of the very beauty and the very nature of the legacy and the mark, as David spoke of Neville and Yvonne's ministry, of Yvonne and Neville's ministry, because they were like them in more ways than one. They were together in ministry, and their legacy and their love lives on. And Neville, who since has brought peace to these lives, knowing how to be in the right moments, knowing what words to say at the wrong time, as we have heard today. Maybe there are people in this service today who need to hear Jesus say to you, peace be with you. To allow Jesus to deal with the emotional stuff that's holding us back in life and holding us back from knowing Jesus in all its fullness and living a life of peace and joy. After he said, peace be with you, he then showed them his hands and his side, we are told. In other words, I bear the scars and the wounds so that you can know this. And he says to them again, peace be with you. Because this is not just a passive peace that meets your fears and keeps you and heals you and restores you from where you're at. It's also a peace of participation. For as the Father has sent me, so I send you. Kind of Jesus saying, I was sent by love, as a gift of love, to love. And I challenge you, I charge you, my disciples, to step out of your love space, to step out of this room, and I send you by love, as a gift of love, to love. It is this metanoia. It is not just a meticulous Jesus. It's a metanoia Jesus. It is an all-transforming Jesus who says, you can go and change the world. As the Father sent me, so I send you. And if Neville could say something here today over us, apart from his jokes, which I love, he'd say to us, play your part in changing the world. Go in the name of Jesus and change the world. So as Neville crafted so much of life, his marriage, from the time they met at music school in Birmingham, right through the years of almost 39 years of marriage, and he crafted his relationship with you, with God, in holy matrimony. And he crafted his relationship with his children and his wider family, as he crafted his ministry as a Salvation Army officer in all those appointments, as he crafted the networking of community ministry through emergency service response and community life in different appointments. So he would say, let Jesus craft you to be the person that God wants you to be. So that today we can say these words with all hope, with all assurance, with all confidence. The words that Charles Wesley penned, and we often say, finish then thy new creation. Pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation perfectly restored in thee. Change from glory into glory. Till in heaven we take our place. Till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise. Today, Major Neville Andrews, you see and live in the glory of God. Faithful servant of God. Well done. we, today, can know the peace of Jesus, and we can see and experience the glory of the Lord, because we can go from this moment, sent by the Father, in the strength of the Lord. Let's stand together and sing this song. The children of the celebration of the Lord. Relevant difference of God's blessing over our lives today. Whatever you're feeling today, whatever you're carrying, whatever you're holding in these moments, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord take care of you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace, now and evermore. Amen. And as the cortege exits our service of celebration and thanksgiving, we're going to listen to some beautiful music. Hide me under his shelter.